So let's try to make it quite straight a few things here, because we are in a big a theater, see a few people coming over, and anybody of you has coincidentally attended my previous session yesterday, actually. It was about building a bot to order a pizza. Today we are speaking about spaghetti, so it seems like I'm Italian, right? Yes, I am. And just to make it clear also, this is not a cooking class, it's about microservices. So it's really about how we can evolve from a spaghetti, a convoluted architecture, to a microservice, highly scalable application, highly scalable architecture. We'll do it as a journey in the time that we have. It's a long journey. We try to condense in an hour. And we go in two steps. The first one is, let's discuss what are the benefits of going towards a microservice architecture in two steps. The first one is by introducing the concept of enterprise service bus. Why it's helpful and what are the limitations, why it is a pattern in enterprise level applications, but why it's also an anti-pattern in microservice-oriented architecture. And then we get more into the offerings in Azure, the Azure Service Bus and Azure Service Fabric, similar names, completely different concept. All right, so let me get a few slides, and then there is a bit of live demo on the service bus, and excuse me, a few some sample code in C Sharp, also how to connect to Azure backend and use the services of the service bus. Now, service bus specifically in Azure provides a very beautiful pattern called the publish subscribe pattern, where you can publish your topics, you can publish your messages, and have the service bus processing, delivering, and application subscribe and listen. But not too much anticipation now, okay? Let's start to understand first what the challenge that we are trying to resolve, why moving out of spaghetti is a good thing, although tasty, but not in IT, not in enterprise level application, and how moving towards microservices is actually a good thing for scalability and high availability of applications. So that's probably some of you, or most of you, may be familiar with a situation where you have to integrate a different type of applications, where you have your customer relationship management system, where you have your website, or you're building some mobile apps, or a different type of application that are part of your ecosystem. How do you connect them? Well, there are plenty of technologies for connecting systems. You can call an API, you can call a web service, a RESTful endpoint, or you can transfer files, you can batch process text or CSV files, or even an SFTP server if the application is a remote destination. So you can upload a file and then process on a batch schedule. So there are different ways of integrating systems. But where's the challenge? Well, the challenge is when you start, your CRM has to communicate to your mobile apps. So it is over some RESTful API. But to your website, maybe there is a backend service where you post into a database table, and then the CRM pulls the data from the database table. And then you want to transfer a large data set to a data warehouse to build some business intelligence on top of it. Or what else? From your mobile apps, you want to build some dashboard on top of the data warehouse, using Power BI, using Cognos, using business objects, to try to identify some insights into your data. And then you want to send an email with some reports. You get the message. You start getting extremely convoluted, right? So all different applications talk to each other, point-to-point connection. Now, What's the challenge there? The challenge is that any of these integration points are a potential point of weakness. If it fails the connection, you fail the integration. You need also to secure them. Each of every single point of integration is a vulnerability, is a backdoor into your system. You need to secure them. And technologies evolve. If you start 10 years ago, maybe you would do a WCF service, or actually 10 years ago, it would even be a text file. 5 years ago, WCF service. Recently, we will do a web API, a REST API. So technologies evolved. The people that have to maintain these different technologies evolve themselves. So it starts becoming also a challenge to maintain. What does it look like, all this convoluted, intricated pattern? It's a spaghetti plate, right? So it's something that, yes, maybe testy, and I did cook this spaghetti myself for the picture, but in IT, in microservice architecture, in IT architecture in general, is not a pattern that helps scaling. It does work, point-to-point connection, and probably is the quickest way of doing it, but there are challenges in availability, challenges in security, challenges in maintenance and evolution of your integration points. Now, there's an interesting recent, I would say, trend that is emerging in the market, and is the trend of the microservices, which are not replacing, is a challenge to say are replacing, but they are evolving the old concept of the service-oriented architecture, of the SOA, or SOA. Now, what is about microservices that is different? Where SOA architectures were targeted to reusability of services, so try to build services that can be reused by different applications, microservices-oriented architecture are trying to resolve a slightly different challenge. The challenge of replacement and scalability. Replacement as in, I have this microservice, I have this service that does something very specifically, does one thing and it does very well, say make a quote for booking a hotel, and then you want this service to scale. So you want to scale in order to support thousands and thousands of transactions. If you were building a monolith, no? So if you were building an application that is not only about making a booking for a hotel, but it also print the invoice and process the payment and everything else that you can think of in terms of arranging your holiday, then that application would be so fat in some way that if you want to scale, you need to approach it by scaling, adding more power into your infrastructure, adding more clusters, and that comes with a cost. It is possible to some limits, physical limits, but it does come with a cost. Microservices are approaching the scalability by trying to isolate as much as possible the one thing that they do and do very well. And when you want to scale, you scale only that one functionality that you want to deliver to the thousand or to the millions of transactions without impacting the rest of the application. So if your bottleneck is in the online booking, you don't have to create an infrastructure that supports the entire monolith, the entire fat application. You need only to take the one service out of the big picture and create a cluster of containers or serverless functions or whatever is necessary to scale that one single service without touching the rest of the application. It also valid in terms of scaling down. So during a low peak period, your fat infrastructure that has hundreds of virtual machines is going to cost you a lot of money. And taking them down is, you know, is a process of automation that may not be super easy to do, especially if you are sharding data between different virtual machines. So you are distributing services over different virtual machines to create a kind of load balancing. You can't easily take virtual machines down. And in my organization, we have situations like this, where we are distributing physically services over different virtual machines to create, I would say, an illusion of load balancement. So this basically prevents me from scaling up and down, and especially down, because I can't kill a virtual machine. It's running a service that is nowhere else. Now, what's the challenge there? Cost. Running virtual machines costs a lot of money. A microservice in its isolation can scale up and down. Now, back to the pattern that I did mention briefly. There is a pattern of microservices that is actually going into the direction of looking like spaghetti again. And this call the Death Star diagram. And who is responsible for that? Well, microservices are actually now becoming so trendy that companies like Netflix have published this diagram that is not super clean from the screen, but there are thousands and thousands of microservices, but really, really micro, as in super, super small, and all the blue stuff in the middle, if we could zoom in, is actually lines of connection between microservices. Now, we've been talking here for 12 minutes, and you're saying that spaghetti is not good. This one is even worse. All right, there is a way of doing good. The picture doesn't look great, and I get it. And actually, it's called Death Star, because it looks like, from astronomy perspective, a star in its dying centuries or years or whatever. It's a blue star. For who has studied astronomy, a blue star is a star at the end of its life. Now, the blue star, the Death Star, can work well if we use some technology, some patterns that go under the name of Enterprise Service Bus, and some technology that in Azure are called Service Fabric, but there are different ways based on containers, based on like Dockers or Kubernetes that provide the level of integration. And it also goes well if all your services have a kind of API wrapper around them, and you have an API gateway that manage the interaction between all your services. I'll get back to that in a moment, but let me clarify the first step of our journey towards microservices, which is the benefit of the Enterprise Service Bus in this context. In the context of making your integrations less convoluted and more linear. So, the previous screen, we had all our services and they were all talking to each other. It works, but it represents some challenges. The ESB is a kind of typical middle layer. Every middle layer comes with benefits and challenges. Let's try to identify a few. But the benefit that the ESB brings, first of all, it makes integration cleaner. You see, there is no convolution any longer, but we still have 8 systems talking to each other through a middleman. Now, as I want to add the 9th, the 10th system, I don't have to create all the permutation of integration between the 9th application and all the other ones. I need to create only one. Talk to the ESB. The ESB translate all the messages to in and output from the application. And also, an ESB provides a message-driven pattern. I send a message from web application, I send a message, the message is propagated into the ESB and can be processed by the other applications that subscribe to that kind of message. Now, this is the publish-subscribe pattern. As a web application, I publish a message. I send a signal to say, hey, there is a new form that has been submitted from the web application and contains information about booking an hotel. So that is the message that comes from the web application, can be any application, right? I'm making the example now of the web application, where a form is submitted. It's a specific form, and it's a form containing information about booking of an hotel. Where this message goes? It doesn't go directly to the CRM. It goes to the ESB. And it actually goes into a queue of messages. And the beauty of being in a queue of messages is that if the CRM is for some reason sleeping, and CRM are a bit of an elephant that sometimes go to sleep, the message is not lost. If you were doing a point-to-point integration, you will need to build your own queuing mechanism to make sure that the message is delivered. So a queue in the ESB is a way to guarantee delivery. And if your message failed to deliver, the bus is able to retry a number of times until it succeeds. And if it fails, you have monitoring in place to see why it failed. Now, a part of the ESB, which is a benefit but also a challenge, is that you can create workflows. If the message is sent and the message has some conditions, you can massage a bit the data and you can apply some transformation and you can send to target destination, target applications that have subscribed to receive that kind of message. It is an opportunity because you implicitly are applying some form of security to your messages. Not everybody can read the information in the message, only the application that have subscribed. And this concept is implemented using topics. We'll see that in a moment over a live demo, where I send a message to a specific topic, only application that are subscribed to receive that kind of message from the topic are able to receive the message. So implicitly, you are applying some form of security to your message. The challenge, the risk that I noticed in several years of experience of implementing ESBs is that people tend to build a lot of business logic in there. Business logic as in, I'm sending my request for hotel booking. I am qualified as a goal customer, and then I put some discount as part of the workflow so that I can send the message to the web app or can send an SMS containing the last price or the email with a confirmation directly to you, even without passing from the line of business application, which in this case would be the CRM. Now, what's the challenge? The challenge is that you're consolidating, you're building a lot of business logic inside a layer that is not meant to have business logic. Business logic is in the line of business application, business with business. The ESB is for integration. You can do a bit of data manipulation, it's fine. So, for example, if the web form contains an address, you may want to validate the address calling Google Map API. That's absolutely fine. You're doing validation, you're doing data transformation. But if you want to apply business logic, that's not the place. I've seen it happening, and it happens because ESB are such a powerful platforms that you can even program in C#, in Java, in Node.js, and build applications in there. So they are used like middleware for delivering business logic. It's a challenging approach. I'm not saying it's wrong, I'm saying it's challenging, because then you maintain a lot of business logic in a central place, and again, it goes against the scalability. If you want to scale your system that provides discount, if it is in DSB, DSB is a monolith and doesn't scale. It helps on message delivery. It helps on security. It helps on message queuing, but it doesn't help on scalability. DSB is a bottleneck, may be a bottleneck. Let's say things in a good way. May be a bottleneck if your requirement is high, very high scalability. Hence, I mentioned at the beginning, ESB is some school of thought, consider it an anti-pattern in pure microservice architecture, because it's a bottleneck of scalability. Said that, the advantages are enormous, and in used properly, without business logic, but only integration logic, it works efficiently. Now, there are several players in the market for enterprise service bus, and some are completely cloud-based, some can be hosted on-premises, some have a hybrid configuration, so you can really play the way you want. I'm gonna show you now the Azure service bus. It's a completely cloud-based service that, where you can send message to the queue and then subscribe to the message, receive the message, and process it. And the way it works, so let me get out of slides and get into Visual Studio, right? So maybe I will zoom in a bit. Let me show you what it does first, and then we go through the components. There is a bit of C#, I'll try to keep it lightweight in any case. The idea is, I start the application in the meanwhile. The idea is I'm ordering some stuff, some food, and I want to rate the quality of the food. This rate is collected in a web form. I'm not a web designer, so forget, there's a bit of a strange lines on screen. So forget the beauty of the form, which is not there. We are looking after the implementation. And then once this is submitted, it will go into the bus, and the bus will propagate the message through a queue, and will get captured by our CRM. All right, so actually, let me just double check quickly that I configure things to work with the queue, which was not the case. Here it is. Okay. Here it is. Now, that's the good one. Because I want to show you the two things, using the queue and using the topics. There are slightly different ways of doing it. All right, so I have different items, some pizza, some spaghetti, a tiramisu, a gelato. I buy, I do a vote, I rate it, and then I'll send this message to the bus. Now, what is the bus? The bus is actually, let me get into my Azure portal. The bus is a service offered by Azure that you can configure in really, really few minutes. All you have to do is search one second, let's see if I can zoom in a bit. Here we go. For service bus. Boa, service bus. And it should come out in the list of services available. Service bus, the Azure service bus. Once you create, it will take a few minutes, so I'm not gonna create now. I already have one existing for which is here, service bus. Once you have created, you have something like this. You have a dashboard for managing the service bus, where you have the possibility to create queues and topics. You create as many as you want. A queue is, as the name implies, you send a message to the queue, and it will, and any application that listens to the bus will read the message. Any application is simply a queue. So it provides guarantee of delivery. It provides all the security because it's an endpoint over HTTPS, but it doesn't provide the filtering of the subscriber application. If you want to have that additional level of security, you need to run as a topic. So let's go with the queue first. I'll create a queue. I need to give a name. So I'm doing ratings, so let me call it ratings queue. You can size your queue. What is in the queue? In the queue is you store objects. How do you store them? You typically serialize. How do you serialize? Up to you. You can serialize as JSON, you can serialize as a binary, contains object. JSON serializer using Newtonsoft is probably one of the easiest ways of doing it. So then you have to think about the size of your queue. Some parameters about the life cycle, and then you create the queue. So it should take 15 seconds or less to create the queue. And let me see, done, even shorter. So the queue has been created, perfect, and I have my queue in here. If I open my queue, you will see at the moment there are no messages, 100% of free space. Is ready to accept messages. How do I connect to the queue? I need an access policy. So I go into my settings, take my access policy, and Azure does all for me. It's all pre-configured. If it comes up, come on. Okay. Access policy, there we go. And then in the access policy, you have a connection string. You copy the connection string in memory, and then you go to your Visual Studio project, and you put into your web config. And I say, this is my service bus connection string endpoint, blah, blah, blah. This is the access point. And somewhere here on the right, there is the password that has been generated. Hey, don't take a picture of the password. Okay, so from the application, so from here, let me switch to my web application, which I have lost. Here it is. Once I have a pizza, and I say it's 5, I'll send my vault, hopefully it works. Okay. One second. It didn't really work. Let me see if my APIs are running. They are running. Yes. Let me see. Q client. Yes, okay. No, sorry, I'm the wrong one. I'm in the wrong one. Process JSON, API ratings, controller, going. Okay, maybe I need to republish, I need to rebuild my API. Give me a second. I republish my API because I think I only commented, but I didn't rebuild. So now that should work. Rating, vault. And thank you, rating submitted. So what happened? Let's have a look at what happened behind the hood, okay? So That was an MVC application. There is a controller. The controller is using an HTTP client. It's on the screen there. A bit, let me zoom even further. There is an HTTP client. It's creating a post asynchronously. Every communication with a message, with a service bus is asynchronous. So it sends a post to a URL, which is the endpoint of your API, and then just return the successful completion of your submission. So that's all about the submission of the API. Oh, sorry, the submission of the message to the API. From an API perspective, I connect it to the service bus, and I do it in either way, as a queue or as a topic. As a queue, I need a name. That's the name of the queue that we have entered before. And I need a client, a queue client. And for topic, we'll see there is a different type of client. So I need a queue client. How do I get a queue client? From a connection string. And the connection string is something that I have defined in my web config. Okay? So from the connection string, I use this factory, I generate a client, and then my post for the rating is basically a serialized object in JSON. It can be anything really, but it's a serialized object of my value that is sheltered by the broker message. This is part of the service bus application or service bus framework, and then is sent to the client. How do I get this broker message? This is a NuGet package, which is called windows-azure.servicebus. So you add this package to your project, and you have all the framework, all the libraries, the namespace for connecting to your service bus. So as you can see, when we tease developers that it really takes two lines of code to do something, it does take two lines of code. You need a queue client and get a connection from the connection string, and then serialize your message and encapsulate as a broker message and then send. All right, three lines of code. That's all about the post. And it goes to the message. The message goes to the bus. So let me see if it's there, if it arrived. You know, it's a long way from India to North Europe where my service bus is configured. Let me see if it's there. Rating queues, rating queue. Here we go, we got our message. So our message has arrived. Doesn't have any impact on this free space. It's two items, no? It was pizza number 5 as a JSON. It's really a few bytes. So it doesn't really impact the free space. We have allocated 1 gig, so it's plenty of space. But we have our message there in the active queue. Now, I want to read this message. For now, what I only have done is a client application I published into the bus. I want to read it. So what I have is a fake CRM application. I didn't really want to bother you using Dynamics CRM or Salesforce. And instead, I create a fake CRM. So this fake CRM is, again, an MVC application. And what it does is read the message that is in the queue. And hopefully, if I refresh, it will work. Endpoint not available. Yes, it's going to the topic. Sorry, I need to go to the queue. So let me fix that quickly. Rating operation. So I want you to go, yes, here. So let me close the topic, not to create confusion. I want to go, when I click refresh, I want to go to my queue, which obviously is the same name, create again a connection, and then when there is a message, so this on message is an event, when the event reads that there is a message in the queue, get the message, deserialize, and add to my CRM. This add is something that fakes in creating a new rating into the CRM. But these are the two lines that you need. You need to get the body of the message, deserialize, and obtain your original entity. All right, so if that works now, let me recompile and run. So we didn't touch the message. The message is still there. The application just failed. So, and that is, you see, I proved involuntarily, didn't make it on purpose, but I proved that if your CRM is not available, your message is not lost. It's still there, and then it can be processed the next time your application is available. So I'll go, open my browser, and hopefully I get my pizza message. Let's see. Refresh. Come on. Here we go. My pizza is there, has been taken out of the queue, and is now with a vote and with the total count. So how many messages have been sent. And if I do this over and over again, I will keep on adding. If it is a pizza, increase the total count. If it is any other one, it will add the new record to my CRM. So again, that was the typical 2-3 lines of code to read using the same queue client, using the same connection string, and just responding to the on message event. Okay, that was about messages. That was about the queue. Topics is the other capability of a service bus that, as said, it provides queuing of messages, but also the subscription part of it. So not every application can read from the service bus, only application that subscribe to that specific topic. How that works, you will see, is extremely similar, just a few components are different. So first of all, we need a topic. So let's create our topic. And we call it, let's create our topic, yeah. Ratings topic. Again, size, lifetime of the message, create the topic, and very quickly a new topic should be available in the service bus. Service bus creation, running, here we go, topic ready. And if I open my topic, zero messages just created. Now you will see there is a subscription button here. That's the difference with the queue. Here I have to specify what is the application or the applications that are allowed to read from this topic. And the application, you just give a name, and then I use that name to connect, is my fake CRM. And it should come up here. Here we go. So there are no messages in the fake CRM subscription. Let's switch back to code. So from my application, so from the client application, from the web application, all I have to do is not use the client, the queue client, but use the topic client. Done. Same connection string. I'm not changing the connection string. It's connecting to the service bus. I'm not changing the post. It's still serializing and still encapsulating as a broker message, and it's still sending to the client, to the bus client. So the way it is posted is exactly the same. The only change is instead of using a queue client, we are using a topic client. That's all about it. So once you settle on which of the two approaches you want to take, that is your web application and will never change. Now, think of the advantages. If you're integrating your web or any application A with application B, and then you are replacing application B, you're not touching application A. If you have a point-to-point connection, well, if you replace application B, the point-to-point connection has an impact also on application A. So you need to make changes on application A to be able to connect to the application B. So another advantage that I didn't mention in the ESB, it is that your convoluted, your spaghetti connections are actually now much more robust, much more maintainable, because the publisher is not impacted by the change of anything that, or any application that subscribe to receive the message. All right, okay, so the client is fine. How about the subscribed application? So the subscribed application is still my fake CRM, which is an operation. And the operation, let me close this. The operation, instead of, instead of running as a queue, it should run as a topic. I need a name of the topic, and I also need a name of the subscription. So that is the additional configuration line that I need to add. Topic name, subscription name. And as you see, we are still using a create connection string from the queue. We are still using a create connection string for the subscription. Just a different factory, but it's exactly the same approach that we are doing. And then we are responding to the on message event of the subscription client, get the body, deserialize the object, and obtain your rating. So very, very similar to what we have done before, with an additional task. So here now, instead of three lines, there are four lines. And the reason is we need to commit, we need to complete the transaction. Topics runs in a transaction. So that means that, as opposite to a queue is first in, first out. A topic is a similar first in, but you take it out only if you complete the transaction, and you have to say, I'm done. And if not done, for any reason, you abort or abandon the transaction. So what's the difference in managing topic is that the control on the transaction, on the life cycle of the transaction, is on the client application, is on the subscriber. Can you guess why? Because the message is available to multiple subscribers, so not just one. The queue is a queue. Once it gets out of the queue, it's gone. So you can't have multiple applications reading from the same queue. It's only the first one that read the message wins. A topic has multiple subscribers. I can have a CRM, I can have a data warehouse, I can have any other application that reads from the same topic. So I can't just decide, hey, I'm the CRM, I'm stealing your message and no one else read it. In this case, it does, to be honest, because in this case, you see, I'm reading the message, I'm deserializing, and I'm setting the transaction as complete. But if I were in a situation of having multiple applications, the responsibility of managing the life cycle of the message is within the logic of the bus itself. So I need to set when it's done, or when the message is still available. Okay. Now, let's carry on with our conversation. Because I have another quick example to show around conversation. So that was a bit of a conversation around the benefit of the ISB, the publish subscribe pattern, as implemented in Azure Service Bus, and we touch on some of the limitations. So not a limitation in scalability, the risk of putting a business logic in there, and but also the opportunity to maintain a very neat and clean line of integration. No? So we mentioned briefly that if once the message is in there, the connection between the web and the ISB is there, irrespective of the applications that read the message. So if your data warehouse, if your ERP one day changes, this web application will not change the way they submit to the bus. And you can easily replace components without impacting the way the message is delivered. So we are going now back to reinforcing one of the benefits of having microservices, the possibility to replace your services without impacting anybody else. So the bus is in favor of this pattern, with some limitation in terms of scalability, but with the opportunity that we have just identified. So that was about service bus. Now, let's try to carry on. We have another 15 minutes, actually a bit shorter, because I want to open up to a few questions, if there are any. Let's try to get to address the other benefit of microservices, which is scalability. So far we have looked into the possibility of replacement, the possibility of securing your messages, securing your application, the possibility to delivering messages consistently. How about scalability, which is another of the benefit of the microservice architecture? Now, service bus is an anti-pattern of scalability. So which one to use? Well, it really depends on the situation. A combination of a service bus and service fabric, at least for Azure, other cloud providers obviously have different services, can help to scale applications and have the level of maintainability and replacement that we have just seen with the service bus. Now, there is a very popular maybe is not the right word to use, but there is an emerging design patterns that helps to create highly scalable application, which goes under the name of CQRS. Is the segregation of responsibility between creating objects, so all the operation of creating, updating, or deleting objects into your repository, and the querying, so or the reading of your information. So it's a separation between doing insert, delete, and update at database level, to make it clear, and doing select. Why that helps to scale? For a couple of reasons. One is what you need to read is not necessarily what you're saving, especially in large application where you have a rich front end. Your front end has a very sophisticated UI that is made of different elements, and these elements very likely are stored in n number of tables at database level. So retrieving all this information is, again, very likely a massive select, joining different tables, getting a result set, and displaying on the web. Or you can do it in multiple select also to get a bit of more transactions, and it's fine. But it's still, your view is made of elements of information coming from different tables. But when you save, very likely you are saving one record per time. It's more transactional. It may be more complex than that, I appreciate. But the way you interact in updating your database or your repository, and the way you rely on the reading or the loading of the information, are two processes that are potentially, they can be potentially separated. How? Well, I'm not going to say that you can even create separate instances of database, one read-only and one write-only. I've seen situations like this. It may be a bit extreme, but for sure you can create app services that run specifically command for update and commands for querying your database. By having two elements that segregates the responsibility of command and query, you are able to create two microservices within the bigger service that you can scale individually. Typically, writing may be more of an effort in terms of your database because there are indexes to update, there are triggers that may run, and there are other tables to update. So you want to have your database cluster a bit more robust, and maybe doing some denormalization of your data and providing to another set of tables that are ready to be read and displayed on the web, on your application, on your front end. So by separating these two responsibilities, you're able to scale your application, optimizing, for example, insert, delete, and update, and having less power on the loading, on the querying. So a level of segregation. More than that, which is kind of visible in here, and obviously slides and the source code that we have seen will be available for download after the conference. But basically, the CQRS, it helps on the separation of commands and queries, and it may be implemented with event sourcing as an additional capability for adding a new level of scalability to your events and to your commands. Let me try to make an example here. As a controller, which is your client application, don't read that as an MVC controller. It can be any client application. I create a command. My command is I create a new record, a new object into the application. So now this command is actually processed by a bus. So it's added to a bus in order to be processed. What that means? That instead of being executed in process, so straight away by the application that is running the command, is delegated to a bus, to a queue of messages that run and potentially scale in complete isolation. So if your application is about interacting with your users, that's the focus. But the delegation of talking to the database is something that you may want to create, you may want to delegate to a separate instance that can scale completely independently. That's the bus. Once the command is in the bus, in the queue, there is a handler that reads from the bus, identifies there is a new command, and creates the object or aggregate using a DDD terminology, and store this object in your persistent repository. Storing generates an event. Event, object is created, object is updated, object is deleted. And this event, again, is not executed, is not processed immediately, but in by the same application that is storing. Because otherwise, you have, again, your storing responsibility and your event handling in the same application. Instead, you delegate the event handling to a separate process, another bus, another queue. And then you have a process manager that looks into the event bus, into this queue, and say, hey, there is a new event here. What do I do about it? I execute another command, or the next step of the application. So by separating responsibility between command and query, so between reading and writing, and between Managing an instruction to do something and managing the event that is triggered as a consequence of that command, you're able to create little modules inside your monolith application that potentially can be installed on separate virtual machines, on separate containers, and potentially can scale individually as you identify any bottleneck. If you have thousands and thousands of events, the bottleneck is on the process manager, and then you scale the infrastructure of your event handler. How do we do that? We have very few minutes, but I want to show you very briefly another example in Visual Studio how we do that. I have an application for an emergency board to respond to some event. Let me launch it. And I want to create a new event, a new emergency event when something happens. So we have some school, some students, and there is an emergency. So what is an emergency event? There is, let me create one. There is a name, a date, the status, the affected school, the location where the event happens, who created, and so on. So there are some attributes as an emergency event. Now, this obviously is when I create, oh, I didn't create, okay. When I create an event, I'm triggering an action. I'm sending a command, and that command also triggers an event. Emergency event created. So what happens? That was an MVC application, so there is a controller, but the controller has an action that I call create a new emergency event. So now we are shifting from calling actions in a controller after the typical CRUD operation, create, read, update, and delete, to the real name of the command. So forget the CRUD. You will name your actions after the command that they are executing. Create a new emergency event. The emergency event goes inside the create action, check the model is valid, which school is affected, and now see what's happening here. I'm adding a new emergency event to a command bus that manage emergency events. And what am I adding? I'm adding a new instance of create emergency event. What is it? It's a command, and there are some properties. The property is the event that I've just created. Now, when I create this emergency event, I said that there is an event that is called property, there is a property that is called event, and this property is a POCO class, a plain object that contains, again, some other properties like a name, a description, start date, end date, status, and so on. So what we are sending in this context here, you see, these are all the command, the event, they are all objects, they are all plain objects containing simply properties. Extremely serializable, unless you do tricky things, so that you can put into a command bus, into an event bus. And once your event is in there, when you create the event, when you create the event raises when you create your emergency, the emergency raises an event that you add to another bus for event itself. And what is this bus? Is again another element, a collection of this element in. There we go. In your service bus. So all these service bus basically are receiving objects, plain objects, but each object represents a command, represents an event, so they can all scale individually. Now, what is about Service Fabric that helps. And here we really have a few minutes, so I'll fly over this slide a bit. But Service Fabric is a very is a kind of infrastructure offered as a platform, as a service, where Azure basically has built most of their services, like Power BI, like Document DB. Most of their services, Microsoft, are implemented are on Service Fabric. It is infrastructure, because it is a collection of containers, but you don't have the burden of maintaining containers, because Service Fabric does it for you. You just create your application to have different process handler, process manager, or command handler, and associate this with and publish this into Service Fabric. Service Fabric will distribute this for you. It will distribute in the cloud if you're running in Azure, but you can also install Service Fabric on-prem if you have your own data center and run this distribution within your data center or in a hybrid configuration. So what it means practically is that when you publish your service bus, your command bus or your event bus, Service Fabric will allocate 100 containers for you. And when you need more power, it will scale that for you. You don't have to manage the load balance of containers. You don't have to manage the allocation and deallocation of containers. Service Fabric does this for you. It is infrastructure because they are containers, but it's offered as a platform because you don't manage it. Okay, so a bit of a rush, I'm afraid, on the Service Fabric, but that's the foundation for running Service Fabric in Azure. We are really at the end. I open up for a minute of questions before sending everybody home. Doubts, fears.